Reminded this week in some of my scripture reading, Psalm 103:5 says, who supplies basically our desires with good things so that our youth is renewed like the eagles. There's so many times where, you know, before I call, I know you answer me, God. You know, I was telling a friend of mine this week about, yeah, time when God gave me a quarter. I mean, it was you know, one of those amazing things. I'm like, God gave me a quarter. I was calling people, you know, and it was, you know, because of the way He did it, just saying, hey, guess what? I know what you're thinking before you even say it, right? But it's just, you time after time, He shows us how much He's with us, and how much He wants to be able to supply our needs. But even more than that, that He loves us enough to even go farther than that, and even He longs to give us even our desires. You know, God is so good. And you know, pray this morning. Let's just take a moment right now. And Lord, you know, we want to invite you here. You know, and We know that you want to be able to dwell among your people. We know you want to be able to dwell in our hearts. God, help us to open ourselves up to you and to realize that even when we feel all alone, even when we feel like no one cares, like you just depression hits us, we're downtrodden, God, we know that you're with us. And Lord, move in us. Draw us closer to you. I praise you, God. Amen.
Yeah.
seated for a moment.
Now, before the ushers come, we were singing that song, you know, and it just I wasn't going to say this, but it's just so strong on my mind. Until he becomes your everything, you'll never know how much he loves you and cares about you and wants to provide for you and heal you and protect you and guide you and strengthen you. And we could just stand here a long, long time and say all the things that he can do for you. But until he becomes your everything, you'll never know that. Amen. Brothers have come this morning. We appreciate your support of our church, and may God bless you this morning richly for your generosity and your selfless giving. God has truly blessed our church, and I believe it's for those very reasons. You know, we were looking yesterday, we were planning and doing some things for the rest of the year for the church, and looking at where we're at with our building program and where we're at in here, and God has blessed this church tremendously. We talked about going back over to North Caravel Road when we first started out with Brother Bell, and we came a long way. And it's not because of anything I've done or you've done, but it's because God has blessed this congregation and this church and this work. And we want to keep him first and at the forefront of everything that we do. And if you give a dollar, if you give $1,000, if you give $10,000, it will go toward his work. I promise you that. We're committed to do what God has called us to do in this community. And you know, as the building program progresses, you know, it's just amazing how the money has been made available. There's not a huge bank account sitting there, okay? But we're giving to missions, and we're doing things and all over the world, and we're doing things locally, and we're doing things at the colleges, and we're doing things where we feel like God has placed the need, and where he's directed us to do that, to reach those needs and meet those needs. And Brother Bell said something, you know, if we can touch one life that will go back to wherever their home country is and reach another one. You see what I'm getting at? You ever played dominoes and you hit the little thing and they all just, you know, that's the way this thing works. And I saw on a sign, it's our sign out there, it says, keep the faith, but not from each other and others. And that's true. We don't need to set on it and hold it in here. It's something to share. I love to share things, don't you? I mean, I do. You know, somebody brought squash last week because their garden had really been blessed and they grew and they were out there for you. He shared that with you. We need to do the same thing with our faith. We do the same thing with salvation and how God has blessed each of us. And when I look out here and see you, you don't have to tell me. I know God has blessed each of you. I know that. I can see that. Let's pray. Father, we thank you this morning for the opportunity, Lord, for the privilege to give back to you this morning. And Father, although it's just a small portion of that you've entrusted to us, we freely give it to you this morning to be blessed and be multiplied, to go forth in this community and to the world, to reach those who are lost, to share the gospel, to spread the gospel, and meet the needs of the lost. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
would open our eyes to see what it is you've laid before us. Help us to realize that the fields are white with harvest. And it takes Christians who are no longer content just coming to church and that being it. But instead, those who want so bad to be a part of the kingdom. Lord, help us to be kingdom-minded again. Lord, let us to see through your eyes. And let us not neglect the calling that you've laid before us. God, we bless your name. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Make up my mind's what he's saying. We're really organized this morning. Little routine we do, you know. Hey, it's good to see you this morning. God bless you for being here. It's all right to laugh, isn't it? I mean, we saw that last weekend, didn't we? How many enjoyed the revival? Maybe the rest of you will next time. No, it was great. It really was. We were so thankful to have Brother Mike with us and had a wonderful time. And I think God really touched some hearts. I do. I believe that. And just continue to pray for him and his ministry. And also, as you're praying, pray for our missionaries. We have 11 missionaries that we support monthly. And if you need a list of those, we'll get you one so you can pray for them each day. They're doing a tremendous work throughout this country and throughout the world and every in different facets of the world. So we want you to pray for them as you do that. If you have an announcement that needs to be placed in our bulletin, please get that to Sister Judy by Wednesday night. You can do that a number of ways. You can hand it to her. You can slip it under her door or tape it to the window, whatever you need to do to get it to her so she can get it in our bulletin. And if you would please sign our welcome pads and pass those by for you and your family, we'd appreciate that this morning. And this afternoon from 2 to 4, ladies' pink lemonade party. All ladies are invited. Ladies, come. June 13th, the youth group's going to Frank Brown Park, leaving here at 10 o'clock. Bring your money for lunch. And, 14th and 15th, this coming weekend, our men's gridiron conference in Birmingham, Alabama. If you'd like to go see Brother Jeff today, he needs to know today if you plan to go. Going to be a great weekend. Going to leave Friday, 10, 11 o'clock, somewhere along in there, and get back Saturday evening sometime. It'll be a great weekend, I promise you, fellas, and it's really not that expensive to go. If you'd like to go, let Brother Jeff know today. June 16th, coming up, Father's Day. Honor your father on that day. Amen. June 23rd, our youth fundraiser, Sunday after service, will be a lunch and donations accepted, only donations. June 26th, youth leave for Forward Conference, return on the 30th. And as those guys go, that's always a great time in our youth life. We want you to pray for those guys as they go. It's always been a tremendous spiritual awakening and refreshing, and we want to continue to support that and just continue to pray for those guys. June 30th will be a Sunday evening, the Panhandle Patriotic Celebration. It's sponsored by our Holmes County Ministerial Association. Our church participates in that, and we're going to give away, well, we don't know exactly yet. We're either going to do water and lemonade or just water. We don't know yet, but we're going to give that out to anybody that's wanting something cool to drink. So be a part of that if you'd like to. Make plans to help us that evening. It's a great time. And this evening at 6 o'clock, your praise and worship team will be at Gritney Baptist Church to do praise and worship for them. And Brother Jared Jenkins is the pastor of that church. And I was talking to him a few weeks back, and he said, man, I want y'all to come. And I said, what you want us to sing? Because we were all kind of talking about it. You know, what should we do? What should we do? He said, just whatever will make the Holy Ghost fall. Y'all come be with us tonight. We'd love for you to be there, okay? We're going to leave here about 5, maybe a little before, but be there. And the service starts at 6 o'clock, so we'd love for you to be a part of that. Our pastor and his wife will be traveling this coming weekend, going back to Houston. And you know what that means. We pray for them, okay? We support them, and we encourage them, and we let them know how much we love them, and we're going to miss them. But let's pray for them that we continue to get a clean bill of health, and we just believe that in the name of Jesus, and there's no reason to believe otherwise. And continue to pray for our pastor and our youth pastor and our associate pastor and all of our staff here at Northside. They're doing a wonderful work, and it's a hard job sometimes, but they're doing a great job, and we appreciate them. Amen. Our pastor's going to come now. We're going to turn it over to him. And as he comes, we'll dismiss our children to Children's Church.
Yes, yeah, stand to your feet. Shake hands with somebody. We'll dismiss our children to the back. And you can reassemble. If you want one of these front pews, you may get it while somebody's standing up. Just a thought. Okay. All right. Glad you're here, boys and girls. Hope you have a great time in Children's Church and toddler time and nursery. God bless you. And bless you parents for bringing them today. Good to see you today. I don't know how all of this fits on the airwaves, but anyway, I guess all of our milling around still goes out there. I don't know. But anyway, it is being aired, everything that you and I do, beginning with our song service. So we're just glad you're here. Trust God's going to continue to manifest His presence. His presence means everything to you and me. So we want to get into the Word of God. We're going to be talking today about God's seal. God's seal on mine and your life and what that means. And we'll just share some more. How is it most evident in our lives? And we'll be discussing some of those things. On Wednesday night, we went through a study of the Word of God. And now we're working on the Spirit, a study on the Spirit of God. And it just helps you and I to know. God said grow in grace and in the knowledge of God. So we do the knowledge through His Word. Knowledge, information without importation, without the power of the Holy Spirit, would be of little value. And so we want to emphasize on the Spirit. and how the Spirit and the Word works together. In perfect agreement, by the way. So we'll begin our scripture reading in 2 Corinthians chapter number 1, verse number 21 in our study. Now he hath established us with you in Christ, and hath anointed us is God. He that established us in Christ, he also has anointed us, and he is God, who has sealed us and given the earnest of the Spirit in our hearts. And then in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 19, it talks about some foundational issues. The foundation of God standeth sure, having this seal, the Lord knows them that are his, and let everyone that nameth the Lord depart from iniquity. So let us pray together as we ask God to open up these truths to us today. Father, we thank you today for your word. We thank you for the power of the Holy Spirit, Lord, that brings alive the word of God and its manifestations, Lord, to us. We pray that you would help us today. We are dependent, totally dependent, God, upon your anointing to bring about your will and your purposes, not only in this setting, but in everyday life. Dear God, may your presence be strong, and may we have a realization, Lord, that you are always with us, and as your word has declared and gives us comfort, that you will never leave us or forsake us. And Lord, to you will be all the glory and the honor and the glory. Amen. And in 2 Corinthians, he talked about God has anointed us. Now, he anoints us with the Holy Spirit. John chapter 3, you remember the story about being born again. God told Nicodemus, you can't actually get inside into the kingdom of God unless you're born again. What does that mean? Except the Spirit of God come into you. You're born of the Spirit. You've been transformed by the power of God. You can only know the letter of what's being stated in God's holy word. You may know a basic principle, an elementary truth, but we'll never get down to the strong foundational principles that builds a life for God and its beginning. And he said he has sealed us, and he's given us an earnest or a sign or an endowment of his presence into our life. An earnest of the Spirit, and he says it's in our hearts. Now, God places that within us. Now, there's no wonder God said, I have given you everything that pertains to life and godliness. When he comes to live within us, then we must understand we have everything we need. In fact, we have more than enough for us. We talked about that. Giving to others, we must have that flow, more than enough. We must get beyond that state where we're just hanging on. Some of you may still be hanging on, but I got news for you. I got good news for you. It's going to get better for you if we'll follow God. That's just the simple truth of God's Word. God's seal is on us. That's why we know that. God's seal, his endowment of his presence and his power, which is the Holy Spirit. And in 2 Corinthians, he talked about it being a foundational truth. We have this seal. God knows who we are. God knows them that are his. God knows us by name. He knows where we are, what we're doing, what we're not doing. And he knows how to help us to do it his way. And that's important, isn't it? We do want to do it God's way. Now, if we'll build on this foundation, that his presence is within us, it's a foundational principle. We talk about it over and over in different passages of Scripture. Greater is he that's in you than he that's in the world. Submit yourself to God, and then you have power to resist the devil, and he will flee. All of these things work upon this foundational principle that God is with us. That seal. God's ideal plan is to come and live within me and you. The Bible refers to us as being a temple of God. That's what God wants. This is a building whereby the temple comes within and worships together. But God's presence always in our hearts and in our lives. Having a realization of that every day. We wake up in the morning and you don't wake up without God. He lives within you. And God's ideal is to come into you and stay. That is God's ideal, ladies and gentlemen. Anything other than that is not God's ideal. That's what He wants. He wants to come. Unless you and I reject Him and deny Him, He is on the inside of us. That is a foundational issue. If we can get the gist of that and just begin to operate in that, you and I will be able to see and experience signs and wonders. Amen. Hallelujah. Don't you like that? Amen. Signs and wonders. Let me just tell you, I think it's so powerful that when we begin to instill that truth. And I want to go into another passage of Scripture before I continue in this, in these signs and wonders, because I have a particular issue that deals with that, which is the number one sign and wonder that you and I must actually get, or we'll get no farther. But in Romans chapter 5, beginning with verse 1, this is the beginning of where you and I start with it. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom also we have access by faith into His grace wherein we stand, and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only so, but we glory in tribulations also. Sometimes it takes a little while for us to get there. But this is the hope that you and I will be able to glory in God even during tough times. This is what God wants us to get. Possibly, some of our tough times would get better if we could just understand that we have within us the power to do that. Amen. Now, you and I have the power to carry around a lot more than we carry. We just don't do it all the time, even in the natural. So, could it also be a possibility? We know that it is because of the Word of God. That we can also do it spiritually if we will allow the Holy Spirit to have its work in us. He says, not only so, but we glory in tribulations also, knowing that if we're dealing with tribulation, there's something working in us. And probably one of the things that we probably really want the most is patience. Because we're living in a culture of a push-button culture. We even, in some of the commercials, one of them particularly, the easy button, I've referred to that. We all like that. Well, mine and your easy button is the Holy Spirit. For He will strengthen us. And He is that treasure that's in an earthen vessel. And we as children of God, we must understand that God's seal is on us. He is in us. And He's empowering us to do His will here on this earth. And He said, patience, experience, hope, and hope makes us unashamed because, and this is where I want to move on with this, because the love of God is shed abroad in our hearts by the Holy Ghost, which has been given to us. For when we didn't have that, we were without strength. Jesus died for us. Even when you and I did not have this and we did not know the love of God, we were not loving people, Jesus died for us anyway. And as a result of that, you and I can have the seal of God upon us. And it can be realized. And it can be experienced. And I want to deal with this most obvious sign and wonder, which is the love of God. Some of you didn't think I was going there, but this is where I want to hang for a while, is the love of God. The Bible says that His love is in our heart. When He talks about shed abroad, He says, I want to fill up the whole spot in there with this by the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, this is a God thing. This is how we get it. If we don't have it, we can't give it. So one of the signs and wonders that you and I need to count as number one on God's list is the love of God abiding in our heart. This love of God. What will you see when you and I learn and we teach our children about this love of God? What will we see? I can tell you what we'll see. We'll see a continuation of our children following God. Hallelujah. Now I realize our children, they got choices just like you and I have. They can turn and walk away if they want to. But I'm just saying, if we can get this right, we will. The statistics that the world has will be different with me and you. If we can get this right, it's foundational and it's very important. And one of the signs that I want to begin to see within this church is when our children get college age and they get graduation age, we'll hear them saying prayers at our baccalaureate. We'll see them like some of you saw on the television, that a student that was had this speech that was approved by everybody. Just tear it up. And through the boldness and the power of God, just recite the Lord's Prayer. Because the love of God is in that child. And we have a salutatorium. I wish I could have heard this better, but I couldn't really hear it like I wanted to. Bailey and Vernon, when she prayed, and she prayed that God would come into the hearts of these students where they could find purpose in life, and that He would fill them with the Holy Spirit. He would save them and fill them with the Holy Spirit. That's what I want to see. This is a sign and wonder in our generation, ladies and gentlemen. When 80% of our children grow up and they leave home and they leave the church, I want that to change. And I believe if we can make number one the number one issue, we'll see that change. We'll see the love of God and the power of the Holy Spirit working in our children. And we'll be able to see signs and wonders in our children that they'll go on to know the Lord. And they'll still count, coming together as God's people. We come together because we love God and because we love one another. I like to be with my wife because I love her. And she likes to be with me because she loves me. Hallelujah. We love each other. We have differences, but we love each other. And we are committed. That love is committed to each other. It's not about what I can get from her. I benefit a lot from her. She benefits a little from me. But it's not about that. There's a higher purpose. I must love her. And if we can get this thing down right, it doesn't have to be a forced issue on mine and your part. If we can just simply learn to work with this foundational issue, God has, His seal is on us, and this is how He wants you and I to operate. This seal, this earnest, is kind of like a sign. You know, you've heard that story, people do things, here's your sign, you ought to know better. Here's your sign. Well, you and I have got one. We have a sign. We have a seal of the Holy Spirit in our life. Some of you have probably listened to a commercial. It's called the Yellowwood commercial. You remember the guy? He's got that little yellow sticker, and it's on the end of those 2x4s and those boards and all. And he said, if you don't see this sign, believe me, you don't want it. And I'm going to tell you, ladies and gentlemen, if they don't see this sign in mine and your life, they don't want what we got. But if they can just see this, because there's something within that wood that makes it durable. There's something within that yellow wood, why it's called yellow wood. There's a treatment in there. Just like you and I are experiencing with the power of the Holy Spirit, that creosote gets into that wood by pressure. Sometimes the only way you and I can experience the power and the operation of God is through pressure. If that's how He has to do it, God, turn it on. We need it. We need something that's going to carry us beyond the moment where you and I can have the longevity of God and the power of the Holy Spirit to make it through. Have you ever noticed those untreated timbers don't last near as long as those that are treated? and the same ground, deal with the same elements, but the difference is what's within. That's why he said what he did. If you don't see this sign, you don't want it. So whatever's being taught and propagated in this world, if this is not a foundational principle in what's being taught, believe me, you don't want it. I know there's signs and wonders, and I know all of these are good things, but if we don't get this right, this other means nothing. And I'll talk more about that in a moment. But it's the love of God that must be revealed in our lives. The number one issue, all the commands, everything in the Bible. You know, that Jesus was asked, what's the greatest commandment? And, you know, in the Bible, there was a pile of them. You know, I know there was 10 originally that was written on stone, but there was a lot more than that. But he said all of them hinge upon this, love God and love others. Love the Lord thy God with all your heart, mind, and soul, and your neighbors yourself. That's it. I mean, we've got that love God, love others, serve. That's all around us. It's a foundational issue in our lives. And if you and I can understand that we're sealed with the Holy Spirit of promise, we have it in there. We have it in there, ladies and gentlemen. And it should be as normal and natural for you and I to operate in the love of God as it is for a goose to go barefooted. It should be. I'm just saying we've got to get it. We've got to get this. It's on the inside of us. We've been transformed by its power. We've been changed. And we operate differently than we did because of what's on the inside. And John, in 1 John 4:7, he says it this way, beloved. He calls us that. Isn't that wonderful? And so he says, let us love one another. For love is of God. And everyone that loveth is born again, is born of God, and they know God. Oh, that's good stuff, isn't it? Everyone that loves, according to the kind of love that God is talking about here, loves God and knows God, and God knows that person. For he said, he that loveth not, knoweth not God. For God is love. In this was manifested the love of God toward us, because that God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Herein is love, not that we love God, but that he loved us. So this is why we have every incentive and desire to love God, because he sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Beloved, if God so loved us, we also ought to love one another. If we love one another, God dwells in us, and his love is perfected in us. So we're going to do a test in a moment, but before we get there, just know one thing. When the Bible says God is love, love is always for the other person. You don't love someone with this kind of love for yourself. It is totally for someone else. Why in the world would you and I want this in our culture today? When all our culture seems to be interested in is what's in it for me? What's in it for me? But when we look at the love of God and what he has done in transforming our lives, forgiving us all our sin, and promise to forgive us of any other sin if we slip up along the way, and give us eternal life, why would we not want it? We have every incentive, and we should be motivated by this love. That the love of God, because he loved us, we love him, and we love others because of that. Did we deserve it? No. Does the people you and I love deserve it? Nah. But that's not why we love them. That's not why God loved us. God loved us because you and I needed that love. Everyone needs forgiveness. Everyone needs the love of God. And you and I can give it to them too. I thought about that song Miranda was singing and the worship team was singing about never ending This is how the love never ends. God manifested it in Christ on the cross. He manifests it in mine and your life every day. And I preached a sermon not too long ago. Some of you remember it. When we take up our cross and we follow Him. Death to self. See, it's not about me anymore. It's about Him. And so the love of God, He sheds abroad in our heart by the Holy Spirit. It never ends because it's still going through people like you and I. The love of God. The number one priority of God's seal and evidence that He lives within us. It's always for someone else. This is the God kind of love. This is what Paul said in 1 Thessalonians 3, verse 12. The Lord make you increase and abound in love one toward another. He didn't stop with that. And toward all men, even as we do toward you. See, this is not like I do, like I say, not like I do kind of thing. It never works. It doesn't work in marriages, it doesn't work in families, and it doesn't work in the world. But if we will love like God said do it, it works everywhere. It works in our marriages, it works in our families, and it works at school, it works in the world, it works on the job, it works in church, it'll work everywhere. It works. Always will. But this is how it must be done. And if we can get this thing going like it should be, and we can increase, maybe you say, Brother Bell, I'm just really not there yet. Ask God to help you. He will. I can promise you He will. We talked about being filled with the Spirit. God says, how much more does God know how to give you the Spirit to them that ask Him? He talked about the Spirit. God knows how to give it. He knows how to help you to operate in this. We just must talk to Him about it. But it's all about someone else. Doing it for someone else. It's totally unselfish. There's love as. It's for other people. And so we must increase in that. And we are to be the examples in representing Christ. Now I realize we may have a ways to go till we reach the fullness of Christ. But God's purpose in me and you is to transform us into the image of God's dear Son. He did it perfectly, didn't He? Now I know some people would say, I don't know about that. He sure didn't deal with them Pharisees too kindly. Well, it was hypocrites. He just helped them to know the truth. Sometimes the truth hurts. It's not all about being a pansy. You know what I'm saying? It's about standing on the truth. You love people enough sometimes to make them mad if you have to. You love people enough, you'll tell them the truth even if they get angry. Oh, that's like, because they ain't going to like you. We want everybody to like us. You see, Jesus, he operated in that love, but everybody didn't like Him. Matter of fact, the most part of the world didn't like Him. They actually killed Him. But He rose from the dead. He did all that because He loved you and I. So He wants you and I to operate in that same kind of love and to increase and abound in love. And Paul said, as we do to you, as we are your examples. So our children need examples. That world out there needs examples. And you say, well, you know, what if my wife or my husband are not operating like that? That's a non-issue so far as you and I doing it. Because we don't do it because somebody else does it. We do it because it's the right thing to do. We just do it. We're committed regardless, aren't we? We're committed to love God and to serve Him and to experience and demonstrate that. And as a result of that, then we begin to operate in the signs and wonders. In 1 Thessalonians 4:9, another reference to this in Paul's writings to them, he said, but as touching brotherly love, you have no need that I write unto you. You ought to know it. If the Holy Spirit's in there, he says, for you are taught of God to love one another. See, the Holy Spirit's the teacher on the inside. He said, I ought not even have to write this down. He said, but he wrote it down anyway. So you that have a problem with preaching it and teaching it, it's written, and we ought already be doing it. Because the Holy Spirit on the inside of us is teaching us this issue. and is pressing us to operate in that because He is within. That's the great teacher that you and I have, and we operate in. We should be taught of God and His presence within us. I don't want to close. How do we measure up? How do we measure up with this seal and with this endowment of the Holy Spirit and what I believe to be the most obvious sign of His presence? Is love. Is the love of God, the God kind of love. Now, you've heard the story. I've mentioned it. There's different words. I think in America we use love for everything. Sometimes in its translations it's used for everything. But there are three different kind of words for love: eros, philos, and agape. Eros is the kind of love that marriage, I mean, people that are married experience. They have a physical attraction, and it goes a little farther than that. And then the second kind of love is friendship, the kind of love, you know, if you're a friend. Well, I mean, I love you because of my friend. Well, what if they're not your friend? Are you going to love them anyway? See, this kind of love goes beyond that. It's called the agape love. It's translated charity in 1 Corinthians, and I want us to kind of take a look at that. Well, let me go back to 1 John 4:20. If a man say, I love God, and hateth his brother, he's a liar. This ain't true. You can't love God and hate your brother. So if we don't love somebody we have seen, how can we love God whom we've not seen? So that's the number one issue. All right, go to 1 Corinthians 13, verse 4. Matter of fact, I want to go a little farther. Go to verse 1. Can you pull that up? I'm going to just read some things. You and I know it. Now, we talk about signs and wonders, ladies and gentlemen. Now, there's scriptures. Jesus talks about them. In Matthew, he talks about, I'm thinking, all the Gospels, about there's an enemy that's going to come with signs and wonders. Signs and wonders. I'm not opposed to signs and wonders if they're the right signs and wonders and if they're for the right reason. I'm all for it. But this is what he said, and this is where too much emphasis is placed. These things will take place if we'll get this right. But this is what he said. If I speak with tongues of men and of angels, I don't have charity or the agape kind of love. I become as a sounding brass or tinkling cymbal. Doesn't mean a thing. You can pray in the Spirit all day long. If you don't have the love of God in your heart, doesn't mean one thing. He said, though I speak with tongues of men and angels, don't have it. What does it come? Verse 2. Though I have the gift of prophecy, understand all mysteries, all knowledge. I mean, you know, we can be a Daniel. We can do all those kind of things, all knowledge. Though I have all faith, I can remove mountains. I don't have this. Guess what the Bible says? I am N-O-T-H-I-N-G. Nothing. Verse 3. Though I bestow all my goods, give everything away. Sell your house, your car, everything, slam broke. Give it all to feed the poor. Oh, I stand on some issues. I believe what I believe. I don't care if they burn me at the stake. Well, if you don't have this love, you can be burned at the stake and it won't mean nothing. No matter what you believe, you can believe what you want. It doesn't amount to nothing. It profits you nothing. All right, we'll go down now to verse 4. Here's the real deal. This is what this does. If it's in us, this is what it does. This is how it operates. We can say it, doesn't mean a thing. But if you and I can operate in this, and we can learn, and we can get this, then all the rest of these things will follow suit for the right reason. At the right time, that will bring glory and honor to God and not this kind of thing where you and I are making a name for ourselves. It will bring honor and glory to God. It will follow us. I know that. They will follow. There are signs that will follow those that believe. But this is the number one priority of everything else. This is the real seal. This is the foundational issue of whether or not God lives within us. This is what he said. This is what this kind of love do. It's willing to suffer for long periods of time. It's kind. You know, all that hollering and carrying on at home, that don't work. It don't work there. It don't work anywhere else. Not so far as bringing about any benefit. We need to turn the volume down. We need to learn how to be kind. Folks, what you say doesn't mean more just because you shout it. And that includes preaching. To all of us preachers. I know we got a loudspeaker. Sometimes we get excited. I understand that. But it doesn't mean a bit more if I whisper it than it does if I shout it. that mean a bit more. The anointing is no different. Okay? Matter of fact, some people just have a problem getting hollered at all the time. So I don't blame them. I don't like it either. Okay? We don't even like it in the natural. But some people equate that with the anointing. It has nothing to do with the anointing. It has to do with emotion. But he said, charity is not selfish. You remember? We talked about it earlier. Everything that love does, lust is for someone else. It's not selfish. It does not do it for the benefit of self or building up of self. It's doing it for the benefit of that person for whom you are loving. And it doesn't get puffed up like a frog. You know when you really get irritated? I'm not saying you don't get irritated. We all get irritated from time to time. But we're not to puff up, you know, and pout when this happens. Now, I'm not saying we're all there yet, okay? You know, we talked about increasing more and more, okay? So I understand. But what I'm saying is, how are we measuring up so far? If we go to the true test, how do we measure up if the love of God? This is not about bringing condemnation. This is about bringing the reality of faith and love and the real deal. And what we will see if we will follow these patterns. You know, it doesn't misbehave. And there goes another area of seeking not our own. It's not easily provoked. And then it goes into some knots. This is some things. Some things it does, some things it don't do. It don't envy. It don't get puffed up. It doesn't behave itself improperly. And it's not selfish. It's not easily provoked. It doesn't think evil things. This kind of love rejects that. It doesn't rejoice in sin or iniquity. But what does it do rejoice in? The truth. So I want everybody to give the Lord praise. Come on. Hallelujah. See, I've told you the truth. We've got every right to rejoice. I know some of you didn't want to do that because I told you to. That's all right. It's biblical. It's biblical. We can rejoice in the truth. And so, and I realize, you know, that sometimes, you know, you have some of these services where the people's making more noise than the preacher. I don't think you can really get it when that's going on, but there's nothing wrong with us rejoicing from time to time and giving God praise. Just acknowledging the fact that He is truth. And we deal, we believe the things of God. We have a hope and we endure. We like that yellow wood tag. We're going on. Hallelujah. We're going on. I truly believe when this is experienced in its proper sense, we all are in a process of spiritual growth. But we can have the confidence in God's presence in our life that He will finish what He started. Oh, it's just simply keeping the faith. Continuing to trust in God. Yes, the world comes against us. But this is a sign of God's truth. It's a foundational issue. It's the love of God. And if we don't get this right, we're going to be talking about some other gifts Wednesday night. If you want to hear about that, come Wednesday night. We'll talk about them. We'll also be talking a little bit more about these. We're talking about the evidence of God's presence in our life. It's more than lip service. It's about a transformation. And it's about following the Spirit who empowers us. God says, after you receive the Spirit, you will experience the power of God. Now, the main thing, one of the main things, is not only the fact that we do this, but this is how everyone else knows that you and I are legitimate in our profession. This is the seal. This is the number one evidence that Christ dwells within us. And this is what John the Apostle said, or Jesus said rather, in John 13:35. By this shall all men know that you're my disciples, if you have love one for another. This kind of love is not lip service. It's this kind of love. It's the kind of love that Paul said, I want you to love one another as I love you, as I love you. Love is forgiving. You notice that? Love is forgiving. Isn't it amazing how kids that haven't even experienced what you and I have experienced can forgive each other and go out and play? I mean, after they've really had a scrap And it takes months for grown-ups to get over it. You know what the problem is? We're not following the Spirit. We allow that thing to fester. Think about it. Think about it. Think about it. Think about it. Got to get over it. We'll never be what God wants us to be if we don't learn how to follow the Spirit. And love is God love. See, love doesn't keep up with the wrongs. Now, have you ever noticed sometime, especially among our spouses, when we you know, start talking about things and something's brought up, you know, and then somebody brings something up that was about a generation ago. You know, it's like we're keeping records of wrongs. If you really want to mature in the faith, don't keep a record. Don't even bring it up. You think about it. Next time, the old enemy wants y'all to get mad and go to bed and where you can't hug and kiss and all that stuff, you know. Just remember this one thing. God said, don't go to bed angry. In other words, don't go to sleep and angry. Don't let that thing fester. Get over it. You know, get over it. And let's let the power of the Holy Spirit operate in our lives where we can enjoy one another's company. Because if we don't learn how to do this, I mean, where the rubber meets the road in our everyday life, in our homes, and within our families, and within our church, it's certainly not going to work out there. But if we can get this right, and we can allow the seal of God, that endowment, to begin to work in this way, then not only will other people know it, but you and I will experience the other parts that go along with this, which is the signs and wonders. And we'll see things. It won't be according to the statistics that are out there in the world. It'll be because you and I are following God, and God is confirming His Word in mine and your lives with signs following. Let's pray. Before we do, if there's a person here today who says, Brother Bell, I'm not born again. I don't even have the desire in my heart to do what you said. That's evidence that you've not been born again. But if the Holy Spirit is in there, He said He shed abroad this love in our heart by the Holy Spirit. If you've not been born again, you don't have this, and I understand that. And I'm not saying this to condemn you. I'm just saying this to let you know that you can be, you can have it. If you'll repent and believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, He'll come into you. And He will abide in your heart. And you can have this. And if you're here and you say, Brother Bell, that's me. But I want what you're talking about. Would you hold your hand up right quick? Anybody here? Okay. All right, if there's some here that said, Brother Bell, I know it's in there. And each time I'm challenged to go contrary to the Word of God, I need God to help me. Because I'm not doing this as well as I should more often than I'd like to think. Would you hold your hand up quickly? We're going to say a prayer together. Okay. All right, God bless you. Quite a number of hands. Okay, we're going to pray in the closing prayer. I'm not going to ask you to come to the front today, but I do want to pray, and I want us to pray together. If that's you, ladies and gentlemen, this is the number one deal, number one priority of God's presence in our life. We need to trust God with this, and we need to ask Him to help us, that it'll increase more and more. If we're operating as an elementary child Christian, or someone that's just starting out, we need to go farther than this, and we need to do it better, and I believe God can help us to do it. So I want us to pray together in this closing prayer that God will help us. And so you join us as we pray. Father, I thank You today for Your presence in this house and for touching our lives and helping us to see. Lord, we won't get it just because I said it or because Your Word says it. We'll get it because You help us through the anointing and the power of the Holy Spirit. And I pray, Lord, that for every hand that was raised, and God, even for those who may have been challenged in their faith, but for whatever reason did not raise their hands, that You would help us all to mature in this area of love. Lord, let it not be lip service only. God, may we realize, oh God, that the love that you had for us, we can also give because you gave it to us. That love of God is within us. If we don't have it, certainly we cannot give it. But if we do have it, we should be doing it. And I ask you to help us. Forgive us for those times, Lord, when we did not love as you love. Help us to be quick to repent when we realize, Lord, that we're not operating in the love of God. Help us to be quick to apologize and make it right. God, may we begin to do that right here today with our families, with our children, with our church family. God, if we have a sense that we've offended someone, Lord, help us to make it right. And God, help us to be forgiving, Lord, when that takes place, and not allow ourselves to be on edge and get our feelings on our shoulders, but God, be loving one toward another. And as we do this, Lord, the world will know what we're talking about in here is real, and it really means something. God, would you please grant it today as we pray and ask for your favor and blessing upon us as individuals, upon us as families, and upon us as a church family, and Lord, upon us as a body in this world to represent you. Father, it's in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we ask that you would help us. Amen. God bless you, is our prayer. Look forward to seeing you Wednesday night in our study. I will be here Wednesday night and the following. Lord willing, something come up I don't realize. I won't be here Sunday. Brother Chuck's going to be preaching our Father's Day message. And I'm sure God's got a special word on his heart for you. So be here. I want to see if all of our men's real men. See if you can persuade your families to come to church with you. Okay? At Northside. All right. God bless you.